Hi, my name is Kathleen Liu, and today I will be talking about trademark law and the OpenStreetMap Foundation trademark policy. So we'll start with a foundational overview of trademark law, and then we'll discuss the policy and how it affects the community. So first off, what is a trademark? A trademark is a word or symbol or something else that serves as a source identifier for goods or services. So what does that mean? A trademark identifies the provider of goods or services, and not just describes a quality of the product. So let's break that down. In order for something to serve as a source identifier, it needs to give the person who sees the mark an idea of the provider of the goods and services, not just a quality of the goods and services. And there are lots of words out there that will describe whether a good or service is quality, is fast, is cheap, right? But for something to function as a trademark, it needs to answer who that good or service is coming from, not just describe that good or service. So as an example, if you saw a storefront that said delicious pastries, does that say to you, this is a store where I could get some really great tasting baked goods? Or does that say to you, oh, this is part of the delicious chain of bakeries? That's the difference between a word that is a descriptor and a word that can function as a trademark. Another example is if there is a really pretty flower on the store's sign, is that just decorative or is that a logo? The difference is whether it signals to the viewing consumer that this is a particular source for goods and services or it's just pretty. So one important thing to know about trademarks is that they are jurisdictional. So your rights in one country may be very strong, and your rights in another country may be non-existent. Trademarks last for typically as long as you continue to use them and maintain the registration. But again, the rules differ from country to country. So how do you actually get a trademark? There are two main factors. One is actual use and the other is registration. So there are several countries, including very prominently the United States, that require you to actually use a trademark in commerce in order to have rights. Even if you were to acquire registration without actual use, it would be subject to cancellation for fraud. You can also, in the US, get common law rights where you use a trademark, but you don't go get a registration. And that use can have priority over someone later who comes and register the same name. In other countries, including most of Europe, you have to get a registration in order to have any protection at all. But then in other countries, registration is, while not necessary, will give you additional rights and protections such as presumptions or priorities. So what is the point of trademark? The fundamental goal of trademark law is to protect against consumer confusion. So this is really all about what does the consuming public think when they see a trademark? When somebody sees something and thinks, oh, okay, that means that this is from a particular place, we want that to be an accurate perception. So what trademark law does is steer products and services from using away from using names that are too similar to each other. So an example of this is if you have a name that's completely made up, then in all likelihood, if somebody sees that name, they're going to associate it with you. And if somebody else came along and used that same name, then they probably could not get a trademark registration for it, and you may be able to take them to court to stop their use. But at the same time, we recognize in trademark law that providers of goods and services still need to be able to use words to describe the products and services. So for descriptive words, there is a lot less protection, and there is understanding that consumers can distinguish between marks that are quite similar because of the descriptive nature of the similarities. So a good example of this is there is an airline called Air China. There is another one called China Airlines, and there is a China Southern Airlines and a China Eastern Airlines. And these companies coexist. They fly into some of the same airports, and consumers understand the difference, and they look to other cues to tell the different companies apart. Because they expect that it's normal to have the name of a country in airline name and to have air or airline in the name. Similarly, you can have companies that have the same name, but that do very different things. And the expectation is that consumers will not be confused. So there's a Delta Airlines, there's Delta Faucets, there's a Delta that sells heating and cooling equipment, and a Delta that's a bank. And there's probably many dozens or hundreds more Deltas out there. With respect to OpenStreetMap, the terms open and map individually are generic for a map that is out there under an open license, available to the public. But OpenStreetMap is a descriptive name that over time has acquired distinctiveness. So even though OpenStreetMap describes the project, which is an open mapping database, it is not the only name that could be used for that type of project, or the name that you would expect to be used for a project of that nature. And over time, people have heard the OpenStreetMap name, and now OpenStreetMap really means one thing, which is the OpenStreetMap project. So one thing to keep in mind is what a trademark is not. So you will see people use some of these terms when they are talking about what is actually a trademark issue, or you might see a trademark described as a patent or copyright or something else. So the key differences, patent is exclusive rights over an invention. A copyright is rights over that when you author an expressive work, you can't get a copyright over a name. Design rights are about how a product looks, so the product's sort of attractiveness. Publicity rights are about your own name. It's really about excluding others from advertising your endorsement or association. Names can be trademarks, but it's not automatic. It's only if you start using your name as a source identifier for your goods or services that you would have trademark rights. If you're just trying to keep someone else from doing it, that's publicity rights. And of course, relevant to OSM is database rights, which are rights over a collection of data that you've compiled. So OSMF has put out a trademark policy to govern the community's use of trademarks. And this policy was designed to try to cover the general uses that the community sees regularly. So here are some links to the policy, to the FAQ, as well as two license templates for commonly seen scenarios. So just an overview, this is a list of the OSM marks. Most notably, you'll see that OSM itself is only a trademark of OpenStreetMap Foundation in the geo context. And that's because there are circumstances outside of the geo context where the acronym OSM means something else and can mean something else, just like with the Delta example. So I put up here a couple of examples of uses that the policy covers and that are common examples of things that we see. So first off, parody and satire. Some countries extend these rights by law. The policy says this is okay, whether or not your particular jurisdiction extends it by law. It's also okay to honestly describe something as being made with OpenStreetMap data, using OpenStreetMap. You can also compare another product to OpenStreetMap in advertising. And in terms of personal use, you can make t-shirts, stickers for yourself and your friends, your local chapter. But we do ask that you, if you want to sell those, please write to us and ask for permission. The key thing that we want to avoid is any confusion between what is an official OpenStreetMap Foundation project and projects that use OpenStreetMap. So please don't register any domains that are just OpenStreetMap, with whatever domain ending. Please don't make an app called OpenStreetMap. People are likely to think that that's an official app. Please don't include OpenStreetMap in the name of a company or try to register OpenStreetMap as a trademark anywhere. We also, under the policy, ask that you not combine OpenStreetMap with other words to mash together the name of project. This is something that we know happened in a fair amount before the policy was enacted. And we do have a process for people to let us know about pre-existing projects and granting them licenses to grandfather the use under the policy. But going forward, names like that can tend to create some confusion about how a project is associated with OpenStreetMap and with OSMF. So we ask that people not do that going forward. One thing that I want to call out is if you have a product that you, and you want to have OSM in the name of that product, please write to us and ask for permission. We want to look at the context and look at how you're using OSM to see whether that's okay. If it's just the name of, say, an open source project or a tool or something like that, you don't need to ask us for permission. That's covered by the policy where that permission is granted to everyone. For events, if you are hosting a mapathon or a mapping party, that's fine to advertise that as an OSM mapathon. But if you are organizing a state of the map, please write in using the template and get permission. And because we want to avoid conflicts. One key area that I want to highlight is domains. So OSMF would prefer to own domains that include the OSM marks. We have purchased domains for local chapters and then pointed it at those local chapters. The reason we do this is because of possible instability. If a maintainer or two is for whatever reason unable to continue a project, then that domain may expire. It may end up with somebody squatting on it or a company using it for something that's a different, unrelated project. OpenStreetMap Foundation has the resources to maintain those domains and to keep that up. So if you already have a domain that you registered before the policy was in place, you can transfer it to OSMF. We will pay the fees for that transfer, and then we can point it back at you. There are a couple of permission templates up on the website. If you think you need a license, download and fill out that template. If you're not sure, you can write into trademarks at osmfoundation.org to ask. If you look at the policy and you're not sure, if you have one of these uses that might be grandfathered in, please explain the history of your project, when it started, what its relation to OSM is. Send that in, and the LWG will discuss the matter before making a recommendation to the board. We might need some clarifications from you, but if approved, the board will sign and return that license to you. Similarly, if you are organizing a state of the map, please get in touch with the license working group. Check for any conflicts for dates. State of the maps are pretty big events, and we don't want to have them too close together. Let us know and coordinate with us before you start advertising a location and dates. But there's a template online, fill that out and send that in. We'll be internally checking with the State of Map Working Group. And if everything looks good, a member of the board will sign the license and send it back to you. If you have any questions, you can always write in to trademarks at osmfoundation.org. And we also have time for some questions right now.
Now it is so it's the sharing of the OSMF trademark policy is ended, and now we have a short break, and then they will have
Hi everyone, this is Kathleen.
This address or real logo.
The sharing of the OSMI trademark policy is ended, and now we have a short we will have a short break, and then they will have
What's that?
Hi everyone, this is Kathleen.
Trust or will logo the sharing of the
Hi, I can answer questions from the Hackpad. FYI, I have copied and pasted the links from the presentation into the Hackpad. If you have questions later, you can email trademarks@osmfoundation.org to reach the LWG. You can also find me on Twitter at Kathleen the Law. Is there a question you'd like me to answer first, Stone?
Okay, so let me have another question. There's no questions for now. Hello, could you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Because my network is not so stable, I can see the echoes of, I hear the echoes of my voice. Okay. Oh my God.
So, Richard F. is asking, you mentioned that www.osmmirror.com would need permission to take a well-known example. Does that apply to OSM and? And if so, what's the current situation there?
OSM and is an example of a project that application that would have been grandfathered in because it existed and it was using the OSM and name long before the trademark policy was put into place. The LWG is an all volunteer working group, like all the other working groups of OSMF. So there is a lot, there are a lot of grandfather projects, frankly, because the community has been around for so many years. And so basically, we encourage all projects of that nature to write in to us and just formally, you know, put into place their relationship with OSMF. But it is a bit of the situation where if we don't get complaints about people being confused, then a project is not going to be at the top of our list where we need to reach out to them and say, oh, you need to put a disclaimer up or something like that. I see the questions have changed languages.
Change.
I believe that there was a question earlier about logos. So yes. Just to be clear,
should I read the question? What about visual marks about the logos? In a clarification, it reads, yes, the real logo, especially visual appealing attribution without trying to confuse. So using the logo, I guess, to attribute that the OSM data is used.
Yeah, the policy says that it is totally fine to use the logo to accurately link to OSM or to indicate that you're sending somebody to OSM. It goes along with the sort of the concept of nominative fair use, sort of this accurate identification. With logos, it can be, it's trickier to not confuse, but it's certainly doable. Sometimes people will, put a disclaimer or something to make clear that they don't have an official affiliation. And that goes for the state of the map logos as well.
Okay, I have one question about the trademark. So if I, for example, if I'm working in a school organization, it's nonprofit. So the trademark should be unique and must be one logo without any credit issues. Because I know some of the fonts have the credit belongs to the company, but it not should be used by nonprofit, so the fonts shouldn't be used in that logos in some company for business, but for nonprofits, sometimes it can be used. And on the trademark, do they have the same problem?
So if I understand what you're talking about, you're referencing the situation where there are certain fonts that are licensed under non-commercial licenses, meaning that they are available for use by nonprofit organizations or academic use, but not by commercial companies. And my assumption in that situation would be that that would be a copyright license. And there are many copyright licenses out there that specify non-commercial use as a condition. So examples are CC by NC, CC by non-commercial. One thing I covered in my talk was the difference between trademarks and copyright. So trademarks are specifically about brands and the symbols that represent brands in commerce. Something is not in commerce, if it's a personal use, for example, it's not trademark. Of course, there is, even for schools, right, they have a relationship to the stream of commerce. You know, you pay tuition, schools might have the name of the school on a t-shirt and they might sell that t-shirt, things like that. So the trademarks still are a thing for schools to pay attention to. But with respect to OpenStreetMap specifically, as the trademark policy states, we welcome clubs and local communities, including school clubs, who organize their own mapathons or organize things like that. And those groups are free to advertise their meetings as a OSM mapping party, or things like that, and to use the OSM name and to use the OSM logo to circulate information about those groups. As I said, the only real exception to that is State of the Map conferences, where we want people to get permission, because State of the Map is sort of a bigger event, and we want people to coordinate with the State of the Map working for State of the Map committee before they advertise a State of the Map.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, so if anybody has any future questions, as I said, you can email the working group at trademarks at, oh, there's a, it's plural. I don't know what happened to the plural. It got lost. Trademarks at osmfoundation.org. And you can also reach me on Twitter.
Bye.